Thank you very much, Benedict. It's wonderful to be here. Hello. We've just spoken a bit this morning. I was at the Literature House for a discussion about whether Brazil is bouncing back. And Benedict introduced us and said we would have a more positive perspective on Brazil. So there's a bit of a challenge there because there's so much negative news coming out of Brazil these days. I think we had a very good debate, and it's really great to discuss with you some of the issues that I've been working on over the past 2 years, which has led me to the publication of the book, The Post-Western World. I must say I'm very thrilled. There can be nothing more gratifying for a professor to see your former students be incredibly successful. And there's two of my former students here, and they're just doing amazing things in Norway. So this is, nights and nights of solitary writing experience are sustained by these brief moments of success where you see like people who have been at your class are actually doing great. And then you tell yourself it's because of your lectures, of course. That's one of the examples. You'd be nothing sort of without these things. No, I'm just kidding. But so in that sense, I'll go right at it. Basically, the key idea I want to discuss today is how our theory that we're using, the international relations theory, is above all inadequate to make sense of the developments that we're witnessing right now, and that rather than sort of discussing how our theory can help us describe and predict what's going to happen, we need to adapt the way we look at these things because our international theory, or the theories that inform, that are the pillars of international relations theory, are above all very Western-centric, right? So I want to make 3 points. One which is fairly obvious, but I think it just needs to be very repeated very quickly, is to that there is, of course, a shift of power taking place, and despite the current crisis in some of the BRICS countries, this is above all continuing and is fairly irreversible. The second are the geopolitical consequences, and at that point, I also want to go back a bit and look at the origin of IR theory and how it suffers from a bias, which is now becoming very apparent. And then I'm told we take a break in the middle, and then I think we can have a brief discussion, and then we can sort of come back and look at some of the predictions of how the shift of power towards Asia will affect global affairs, and then respond, of course, to the question whether emerging powers are the saviors or those that destabilize international order. So you just let me know when folks are ready for coffee. I'll just sort of, whenever more than 10 people are kind of dropping to the side, then we'll take a break. And everybody will get some coffee. So, to my mind, the most interesting moment was, or one of the moments that perhaps symbolizes the kind of the topic that I care about here, is when a week after the U.S. election of Donald Trump last year, Xi Jinping came to Lima to the APEC summit, where the world was reeling from the implications of the Trump election and what would it mean, and there was a lot of doubts about whether the United States would stand up for globalization, etc. And Xi Jinping basically gave a talk and said, "Worry not, earthlings, China will protect globalization, and we here ask the United States government to respect the Paris Climate Agreement." And the Financial Times, a day after that, wrote, "In role reversal, China assumes the mantle of sort of the protector of the international system." But above all, there is this profound sense of surprise and sort of perhaps a sense of that most of the observers were perplexed that this could actually happen, because we've come, above all, very used to the fact that the established Western powers are actually promoting sort of the major providers of global goods and norms. And now there's a very interesting debate taking place to what extent China can actually replace the United States as one of the key pillars and providers of global public goods. Before that, of course, I want to, briefly mention a debate that, of course, particularly when you go to South Africa, Russia, or Brazil, the three countries most affected by the crisis, the BRICS countries most affected by the crisis right now, there's a sense that the phenomenon of the shift of power towards Asia was actually short-lived, and we're now actually living sort of in a post-BRICS age, and that after all the expectations that China and other emerging powers would rise isn't that likely after all. But if you actually look at the projections that Jim O'Neill made when the BRIC term, which at the time didn't include South Africa, in 2001, we can see that the actual total size of GDP of the BRICS countries today is actually larger than what Jim O'Neill predicted back in 2001. So the way that historians will look at our time, and this is not something that has ended now, will still be that of a shift towards Asia. So in that sense, the key story, which is happening much, much faster actually than other shifts of power we've lived through in the past, generates this profound, the notion that shapes our time is that of unpreparedness, right? The body of literature, the models, that the theories that we use are scrambling enormously to make sense of this quick shift of power, which is taking place. We can, from a long perspective, look at the period of time that we've lived through and which is now becoming sort of ending as an exceptional period. And this is, I think, one of the key elements where IR theory starts being possibly inadequate to make sense of this, because international relations theory was born when this period was beginning. So basically, the minute this is the U.S. and Chinese GDP compared as a total of world GDP, we can see that in the early 20th century, the United States was on the rise and was making first one fifth and a quarter. And actually, this doesn't appear here, but right after World War II, it almost approached 50% of GDP. So that was particularly the moment when the key conceptions that today inform IR theory were shaped, right? And from that sense, there was a broad implicit notion that the quote-unquote normal was a Western-led international system, right? And that anything but a Western-led system is sort of something that is different. But when we look at the world from a broader historic perspective, this is a graph showing the three largest countries of historical output within the boundaries of modern countries over the past 2,000 years, so 0, 1,000, 1,500, 1,600, etc. We can see that for the vast majority of time of this, of the past two millennia, Asia has been the economic center of the world. So very, very simple. I mean, and the big thing here is this is not at all a secret to anybody except IR scholars. So if you ask global historians or anthropologists or anybody, this is like the first day of class, right? This is very basic. But if you go to IR theory and people, and if you kind of read books like Charles Kupchan or Eikenberry, there's always kind of a history chapter which kind of informs like the origin, the birth of global order. It does have a profoundly Western-centric way of looking at the world, and that sort of Western ideas created the global order. It's very, very rare to find an IR theory book that talks about anything about global order prior to the rise of the West, right? Very little. We have IR theory believes that global order was born with the rise of the West, right? But there's a lot of in the book Post Western World. I have a chapter that describes pre-Western global order, which actually helps us realize that the rise of the West was, of course, very important. The West was very influential. But it wasn't the creator of the West, in a sense, of that global order. There were rules and norms that existed well before the rise of the West. So we can see here that what's currently happening, right? So this is at 2014, we can see that looking at purchasing power parity, the largest economy, again, is an Asian country. So we're kind of going back to normal, right? We're back to normal now in this very unusual period from that we've just lived through, will be seen by historians as what I call the Western blip, right? Very quick, sort of over like 500 years from now, if we'll have figured out climate change by then. If not, nobody will say anything. But if 500 years from now, there's still a human species on Earth, then we will look at that most likely and say, well, that was a very unusual period, right? Contrary to IR theory, which looks at that and says this is kind of the normal. So anything that diverges from that normal is something very, very dangerous, and you know, we have no idea where we're heading, basically, right? So that is a very fundamental point. Another important point that's often overlooked in the growing number of people which says that, well, China is actually no longer growing that quickly, right? The growth rates are going down. That overlooks that through the years, a 3% or 4% or 5% growth in China is much, much more today than 10 years ago, right? So we can see here the real GDP growth, which is going down, but the blocks show the absolute growth, which is actually fairly stable, right? So in 2014, China growing a bit more than 7%, added just as much to the economy than in 2007, when China was growing 14%, right? Because the total size of the economy is obviously growing, so a 3% growth or a 5% growth today is as much as, say, a 10% plus growth in the past. And we can see that here in 2007, when China was growing 14%, added one, basically sort of one Netherlands, one Dutch economy to its economy on a yearly basis, right? So we have here sort of the entire Mexican economy, Australia, Netherlands, and then comes China growth. So that's just taking how much China is bigger 1 year after the past one. And this was in a 14% growth. And in 2014, with a 7% growth, it was basically just the same. That's, it keeps adding a Dutch economy to the economy on a yearly basis. And that's why the argument that a slower Chinese growth to, let's say, 3.5% or 4% will end the trend of multipolarization is wrong, because we can assume that, and I'm fairly pessimistic, I would even say, about the Chinese economy. I think there's a lot of obstacles, and I think China could very well grow slower than it has grown over the past years. In my book, I make sort of a prediction that I assume that it grows between 3.5 and 4.5%, something like that. But even then, because of the size of the economy, the trend of the shift of power and the closing between the U.S. economy and the Chinese economy will continue. It's very, very unlikely that the U.S. economy will be able to grow continuously above 4%. I mean, most economists today agree on that. So that's I think a very obvious issue. I think most people agree on that. But on sort of past conferences, I've once in a while sort of heard people say, "Well, you know, the rise of Asia is over." But that is actually, as I'm showing here, not the case. And this is actually how it should be. Anybody who says that the continuous leadership of the West is desirable basically is asking for extreme misery in Asia, because there's no other way to maintain Western leadership. I mean, if you just look at that, it would be folly to actually say that the United States should dominate the 21st century. It's entirely dependent on an extremely unequal distribution of wealth, which was possible in this very short period of time that we just lived through, right? The Western blip. But anybody who works towards a more a broader distribution of wealth in a world where ideally GDP per capita is fairly equal among people all across the world will inevitably accept that the world must be led by by Asia. There's no other way. And this is how it has been for the vast period of time. And we're already there, of course. The majority of countries, there's now, I think, 112 countries in the world that have China as their largest trading partner. Like Brazil, for example, became in 2000, China became in 2009 Brazil's greatest trading partner. Very few countries will not have China as their greatest trading partner. Basically, all countries in the world today have Asia as the region within with which it trades most, right? So what I'm saying here is, and I'm not making a value judgment here, but if our baseline is that we want wealth to be distributed equally, then this is basically the future. This is the present too, but it will be much, much more Asia-centric than we believe, right? There's no way around that other than sort of hoping for a continuous situation of extreme inequality, which I would suppose none of us would want. And that, of course, this is just another way of showing this, of course, that the vast majority of the human population concentrated in Asia. And that has tremendous implication for anything that involves more than just one country. Climate change, obviously, is the prime example here, where increasingly, in graphs, it's easiest to describe China and not China. Like, those are two blocks that will sort of continue, just like here, coal consumption excluding China and coal consumption in China, which is basically this. The new data suggests that that's about 50-50, right? Half of the coal is consumed in China, half outside of China. And that makes the article by the Financial Times say, well, that's so weird, China is taking the lead in climate change. It, of course, it must lead the global combat against climate change. There's no other way for us to overcome or to survive climate change unless having China as the lead on climate change. So anything else is completely weird. So the notion that Western countries are more sort of, you know, the more enlightened in a sense, that's why they should lead, is completely mad. China must take the lead, and it's very well to pressure China to take the lead. And China is, of course, now assuming increasingly a leading position. And not because it's just, you know, the Chinese government is nice, but the Chinese government, of course, realizes that its legitimacy depends on its capacity to deal with pollution, which is one of the major issues that reduces people's belief in the Communist Party, right? But that is true for basically anything. If you are, and that's not just for sort of the China-branded issues, like there's a lot of stuff about like ivory and gold, but there's today, if you discuss any global challenge, if you don't have a China expert on the table, you basically have no idea what you're talking about, because the notion that a few Western countries can get together and solve an issue is just is an illusion, right? There's no way to do that. But if you look at global history, if you look at if you look at a course at any major university on any major global issue, there's literally no author in the reading list who's based in China or who discusses how actually China or Asia can work on these issues, right? So that's one of the examples of how we must sort of, I think, the strategic reorientation is sort of necessary in that sense. And I would say that Brazil is perhaps the country least prepared for that reality. Very, very difficult, a lot of sort of profoundly Western-centric, and as I come to that in a minute, anti-Americanism is the most Western-centric ideology there is, right? Blame everything on America, right? So I mean, I'm certainly not pro-American, but there's what I'll come to here is both pro-Western and anti-Western thinking in IR has both been very, very Western-centric because we're convinced of Western agency. And that's one of the elements, the basic elements of IR theory is that the way human rights, et cetera, all this spreads is because of Western agency, right? Western ideas that need to be extrapolated to the rest of the world. Anyway, so we can see here, for example, CO2 emissions that are obviously in China, they're exploding in China. There's just two examples. We can see that this will shape the way we discuss all these issues. So why is that so scary, and why does the great majority of IR theorists today believe that multipolarization is above all negative? Is because the entire discussion is based on the conception that the West has been able to set the agenda, right? That the West has created those systems, that Bretton Woods is an extrapolation of US institutions, and that after World War II, out of nowhere, the West based on Western ideas like self-determination, like all these things, which, as we'll see, of course, not Western in any way. I mean, the West participated in that, but it has a lot of non-Western ideas in it as well. So the West, out of nowhere, created these ideas, extrapolated on its domestic experience, and now it's basically losing the capacity of controlling the discourse. It's losing the capacity to shape global order in the way that it desires, right? Because the notion was also, and is very well articulated by Eikenberry, that the global order is difficult to overthrow, easy to join, and that's why the idea is that countries like China, Brazil, and India will join forces and support the liberal system, right? Now, the worries about this situation are largely that the capacity, and this was sort of the responsible stakeholder rhetoric, that the capacity of non-Western countries to actually step up to the plate was often questioned, right? And when it actually did take place, it was often framed in a way that this was actually destabilizing global order. So when the Brazilian government decided to travel, the president of Brazil was decided to travel to Iran to negotiate together with Turkey to try to negotiate a nuclear deal with the Iranian government at the time, this was seen as profoundly destabilizing, right? And the CFR, the Council on Foreign Relations, at the time published a report on U.S.-Brazil relations, and it said, basically, one of the goals of U.S. foreign policy must be to disincentivize Brazil to meddle, this was the word used, in the Middle East. And that's actually, what does that mean? That on very sensitive security issues, there is a prerogative that the United States, as a pillar of the international system, does have a monopoly on actually dealing with that. And having Brazil sort of come into the picture really messes things up. One of the key challenges at the time was to make sure that Brazil wasn't punished by the United States at the time. Another example is the BRICS grouping, right? BRICS grouping, which was for the first couple of years seen as something completely banana, so basically there was no point. It was kind of useless. So the previous book I wrote was on BRICS. So I had the questionable privilege of basically reading every newspaper article that was ever written on BRICS. And I would say they're obviously the sort of the agenda setters, in a sense, the Economist and the Financial Times, etc., literally said, you know, we had just this really weird meeting. And I mean, I've no idea what they're doing. They're probably never going to meet again. Really, because these countries have nothing in common, right? That was basically the line for the first couple of years. The BRICS, for the first time after its inception, they politicized. Their foreign ministers started meeting in 2006. The first presidential summit was in 2009. And now there's a development bank, and sort of it went through a process of institutionalization, right? Sort of in 2012, there was a change because it basically a lot of people realized this is not going away, right? They're continuously meeting. And then basically from negligence to starting to interpret the BRICS as a threat, that those countries were teaming up against global order. They were, you know, creating an anti-American alliance. That was something the key questioning when the BRICS appeared at the ISA, the International Studies Association meeting, for the first time. The topic of the panel was whether the BRICS are jointly destabilizing global order. Because in the basic conceptions of IR theory, when you look at some of the major IR history books, Western powers only appear on the horizon briefly when they're disturbing the creation of international order. And one of my favorite books, Kissinger's Diplomacy, I mean, if you look at actually the role of non-Western powers in Kissinger's Diplomacy, fantastic book. If you haven't read it, it's what I recommend to my first-year students. Fantastic book about the origin of order. But Japan only appears when it makes trouble. And once it's vanquished, it sort of seeds again behind the horizon. Because basically, Western diplomacy is about, the book Diplomacy is about Western diplomacy, right? It doesn't consider sort of non-Western ideas. And in the same way, by the way, nobody who argued these things had read the BRICS declarations, because the BRICS declarations are profoundly status quo. They're very boring, they're very long, but they basically say, we support the UN, we support the WTO, we support the UNDP, we support UNICEF. I mean, it's just a very bland repetition of things. Want a bit more power here, a bit more power there. But it's in no way it's sort of saying, we want to overthrow the order. Of course not, because those countries are either benefiting a lot from it, or in the case of China and Russia, they're very much status quo powers that want to protect their privileges they have in the security structure as permanent members, right? It's still, now it's changing very slowly, but it's still, I still see syllabi about Asian politics without a single person based in Asia as one of the authors of the reading list of courses, right? Which, I mean, imagine basically you have a course in Asia on Europe, and there's not a single European or Europe-based author. It would be unthinkable in that sense, right? And that is, I think, the origins of the fundamental ideas and norms that IR theory produces are still largely based in the Anglosphere. I'm not saying that those are bad. These are very important books, and again, what I'm saying, many of my favorite books are written in those places. But it is necessary to globalize, and the inadequacy of the theory becomes increasingly obvious now that power is shifting away from the North Atlantic. If you have all your power concentrated in the North Atlantic, it's fairly obvious that you should have all your intellectual capacity concentrated there as well. But now, as that's changing, IR theory is taking a long time, is taking quite some time to sort of adapt to those realities. So the majority of people thinks that a post-Western world is chaotic, disorienting, and dangerous. And I mean, it's really quite fascinating. There's virtually no major scholar today who looks at current developments assuming that this could possibly be equal or better when it comes to our capacity to deal with global challenges, right? So very kind of very clear verdict that the discipline makes about current trends. And that is because the standard narrative is that of extrapolation, as we've just talked about. This was in the 60s, an historian who was saying that it's that the world, whoever will lead the world will lead the world based on European ideas, European techniques, European examples, etc., which have basically enlightened the rest of the world. Now, that today, right, so they've shaken the world out of barbarism in Africa and slower, more majestic civilization in Asia, etc., that's no longer PC today, right? The professor can't teach that. That was in the 60s. But if you look at sort of today's narrative, it's not really that different. It still assumes, essentially, that the promoters of human rights and democracy are essentially Western actors, right? It's very, very counterintuitive when a non-Western power protects democracy. But there's plenty of historical evidence that that's actually the case. I mean, just 2 months ago, ECOWAS joined forces to push out the president of Gambia, who refused to accept the results of the democratic election. And after a lot of diplomatic pressure, ECOWAS, which is a regional organization in West Africa, very, very interesting example, very, very interesting attempts to promote regional integration, reduce barriers of infrastructure, etc. So after all the diplomatic efforts had failed, the Senegalese and the Nigerian army moved to the border with Gambia. And at that point, the president Yameh decided to leave the country, right? And it was organized by ECOWAS that he would find asylum in Equatorial Guinea, he and his 20 Rolls Royces. But again, that's a global thing. I mean, that would happen in many different countries. But the fact is, that would not have been possible in many other regions, right? I would bet that despite a lot of diplomatic pressure, in most regions of the world, the neighboring countries would not be able to put that pressure on the country to support democracy. That wasn't a Western-led effort. That was not based on any Western principle. In fact, ECOWAS is the precursor, the intellectual precursor of the first region who actually articulated the concept of the responsibility to protect. Right? So the R2P was used extensively in the region. Now you could say, well, Gambia is a very small place, would have been the same in Nigeria, perhaps not. But what I'm saying is there is a lot of evidence of non-Western engagement with those issues because, as we'll see in a minute, democracy is not a Western concept at all. Religious freedom is not a Western concept. In fact, the whole idea of assigning a civilizational origin to any idea is very recent and wrong. It's a Western idea to signify a civilizational difference between Westerners and non-Westerners in order to sort of project Western civilization as something special, which was used as one of the justifications for imperialism, which is also not a Western idea, right? Imperialism has been around for a long time. So what I'm saying here is basically the shift from Western dominance to non-Western dominance isn't really that profound as we like to see, because the West isn't that different from the non-West. And the rules and norms according to which we organize our international order also aren't really that Western, right? International human rights legislations, international order was profoundly influenced by the Latin American experience, right? So, and Brazil negotiators, Rui Barbosa, for example, at the Hague conferences 100 years ago, was the promoter of international law against European resistance. Doesn't mean, and again, I don't want to, a lot of people read the book and say, oh, you know, you're a post-colonial anti-Western scholar or something. It's not the case, actually. Europe has made tremendous contributions to international law. The only thing I'm saying is to say that the relative economic decline of Europe does not cause the decline of international law, because there is no clear connection that says that non-Western countries are less likely to behave according to international law than Western countries, right? So Eichenberry and Dudney here, again, two people I like a lot, and they're very nice, but I think they have a profoundly Western-centric view, right? Mercosur, another example, of course, now because of the crisis in Brazil, there's a leadership vacuum in Latin America, but there are several examples of Brazil actively supporting democracy. And they're not supporting it because they're signing up to a Western agenda. I mean, Brazil in the 1990s, 1996, 1999, avoided coup d'etats in Paraguay because it affected Brazil's national interest, and because Fernando Ricardo did have the notion that having democratic neighbors created more stability than having autocratic neighbors. And what's happening in Venezuela is exactly proves the point, right? It's having an autocracy close to your border creates trouble. So you can have a public health crisis, a refugee crisis, a humanitarian crisis, everything that Brazil is experiencing right now. It doesn't need any Western sort of outside prodding to do that. Now, Brazil has failed to defend democracy in Venezuela because it have a lot of internal issues. It had to struggle with its own political crisis, economic crisis in the past. But there are many examples in South America as well of Brazil, for example, taking the lead, or Mercosur as a region taking the lead. And there's a lot of rules and norms also to protect democracy in the region. You tell me when to take the first break. Well, there's about three or four sleeping in the back, I'm just saying. No. I mean, you tell me. I
think it's okay to just...
You know, vote? No, autocratic decision. Okay, good, autocratic decision. I have authority and I'll use it. That's right, okay. Oh, and this is kind of an obvious thing, right? But world domination is very... Economic world domination is very bad for intellectual work, right? So the whole, and this is true not only for the West. Anybody here speaks Chinese? My Chinese is terrible. Does anybody speak Chinese or is Chinese? Okay, so I won't say the word China in Chinese because I'll be profoundly embarrassed. But China in Chinese means the Middle Kingdom, right? I mean, that is how China conceives of itself. And that's fairly natural because China was, in fact, the economic center of the world for a long time. And as a consequence, and knowing that, called itself the Middle Kingdom. And there's wonderful exchanges of letters that I read during the research for the book in the 18th century between British emissaries and the court, the Chinese the court, where basically China said, we don't need you guys, we don't need your inventions, because we're the center. I mean, basically the idea that outsiders could bring in something that was interesting to China was ludicrous, right? So what I'm saying is the notion, when you're on top economically, it's very natural to consider yourself as being distinct, and you're trying to cement that difference in order to reduce the probability that somebody else will come on top. And that is one of the arguments that sustains the notion that the end of Western rule has broader negative consequences. Because of course, it's quite comfortable to be on top, right? So there was at the time, and that started with the Opium Wars, basically, which was the beginning from China as seen as the center of humiliation, very difficult time for China, sort of very unstable. At that time, a lot of historians began writing about the civilizational differences between the West and the non-West and said, this is actually something that's much more profound. It's not just our economic strategy, it's our civilization that's profoundly different. And that's why this change is here to stay, right? So that was in the sort of late 19th century. In a sense. So the difference and the profound difference that industrialization produced in Europe made actually, in fact, look societies much different. And then there was this big debate in Europe, which actually existed until countries like South Korea then took off, of course. There was actually a lot of people who said that you can't be rich without being Christian. You must be Christian because there's so many things about your hard work and Protestant virtue and all these things. So anybody who's not Christian will not develop economically. That was kind of the idea. So there's a classic example of extrapolating difference into the past, and thereby saying that because those differences are very old, right? So the West created an idea that the origin of democracy was Greece, which lay thousands of years, 2,000 years in the past. And never mind the fact that between Greece and the 19th century, for most of the time, Europe had not been democratic and had not respected human rights and all that. But that was somehow this stylized as the past of the West. And there was this long trajectory. And that's why there was really no way that anybody else could assume world leadership. That, of course, then changed because South Korea became very successful. Then other countries became successful. There was actually seriously people who adapted that and said, well, Christianity is okay, Confucianism is okay, but Islam really, no way. I mean, there's no way. And then, of course, then other countries came up, so Turkey came up and said, well, but perhaps like Sunni, but not, I mean, so, you know, and so there's still this culturalization of economic development, which is, again, I think impoverishes, I think, our conception of those things. But which also informs IR theory. Again, much more IR theory than global history. If you read Tamerlane, for example, a wonderful book about about sort of imperialism, you'll see that the West didn't invent imperialism at all. There were many non-Western imperialists in the past, right? So the role of the West is overestimated, both good and bad examples. The anti-Western scholars are also Western-centric. Imperialism is the prime example. So I had long debates with a great friend from India, who's a diplomat, profoundly sort of anti-Western, and said the Syrians, the West should have to rebuild Syria, and is basically responsible for the civil war in Syria because of the occupation of the Europeans that occupied Syria after the fall of the Ottoman Empire. Those are the origins of the instability today in the Middle East. And I said, well, but I think the Mongolians and the Uzbeks should also really pay their fair share because they destroyed Damascus in 1400, right? They came in and they just really, there was a great civilization there and they just destroyed it all. So what I'm saying here is it's basically taking the West as more important than it actually is. Also colonialism, great example. In my research, I found a lot of interesting evidence that showed that, first of all, colonialism, of course, and slavery are not Western ideas either, and that there are examples where, for example, when the British, the French, and the Belgians had bases in Benin, the king of Benin actually said, okay, you can stay here for some time, but you can never go to war with each other here. I don't care what you're doing in Europe, but we're controlling Benin, and you can sort of, for the narrative, you can say, well, you occupy Benin. But basically, the colonial powers were unable to take key decisions or to for example, try to expel each other from that post there without the consent of domestic authority, right? So that is, I think that's one of the explanations of looking back, of looking of why IR theory is so Western-centric. So I call that, there's two types. There's paternalist Western centrism, right? That says Western societies have somehow developed on their own. It's really quite common to talk to IR scholars who still believe that, for example, Islam had nothing to do with the development, the socioeconomic development of Europe, right? Never mind the fact that all the knowledge that, that was lost during the Middle Ages was actually recovered and then inserted back into Europe by Muslim scholars, right? And then we have the anti-paternalist Western centrism that basically, and this is, I think, quite fascinating. We see that what Amartya Sen calls the dialectics of the colonized mind, where basically conservative forces in non-Western countries say, we should not do human rights and not do democracy because they're Western ideas. So they're imposed on us. We should resist them, right? Completely mad in that sense because they're not Western, right? We have ample, a lot of historical examples of religious freedom in India centuries ago, right? A lot of communication between those. So, and again, and even sort of leftist thinkers being profoundly Eurocentric, Western-centric, right? Karl Marx, if you read Karl Marx today, was very much overlooked, is he believed that military intervention, occupation was necessary in China, which is quite funny now because if you go to China, Marx is quite popular. But it was basically all about sort of crushing what he called, quote, a semi-civilization, right? So Marx did not believe that India was a civilization worth of its name. So that kind of shows that this is not something of liberal internationalism. This is not something of sort of the only democracy promoters. Marxist scholars are also have those elements of Western centrism. And just as a case study, Shashi Tharoor just wrote a book about the British occupation of India. And one of the interesting things is, and there's actually research done in Great Britain, where the majority of people in Great Britain today thinks that British colonialism was essential to promote democracy, right? This is actually sort of a common thing to say. But if you, and this is, I thought that was a very nice part of a talk that Shashi gave at Oxford 2 years ago. It doesn't stand up to actual evidence because the there was no attempt by the British to actually institute democratic institutions. Of course, some of the leadership in India, the Indian leadership studied in Great Britain, but it wasn't as if the British had were going to India in order to promote democracy. Of course, right. So we can say that India was a democracy despite the fact that it had been basically no experience with democracy during British occupation. And there's all these several examples. Manella wrote a fantastic book called The Wilsonian Moment. It's a wonderful book. If you've got 3 days, it's a quite a big book, but it's basically about how Wilson, it's about the Wilson presidency. And it's about how Wilson was the first president to use the radio to give speeches all over the, to people all over the world. There was the Voice of America was founded. So he was quite, he gained a lot of visibility at the time. And the implicit idea of the book is that because of Wilson, people in Korea, people in Egypt, and everywhere else started to want to become independent. And it is true that it did happen at the same time. Lenin was actually also a big promoter of that. So Wilson had to sort of follow up and say, yes, we want self-determination, which was the big thing of one of the big topics of World War I, right? The British then after the Versailles Treaty were able to hold on to their territories because Wilson was too weak at the time to force them to let go. But basically, this whole thing was about self-determination. But it does suggest that the Koreans and the Egyptians, they would not have come to think of self-determination on their own. There was basically a Western idea. Wilson had to tell the Koreans, you could be independent. And then the Koreans started sort of protesting. The Egyptians started protesting. But Haiti is actually an example of a struggle for self-determination, which was earlier than that, which is successful, and which shows that there's nothing Western about self-determination. Anybody who's oppressed wants this, wants self-determination, right? So there was self-determination against the Uzbeks and Mongols and the West. But it's not, it's not, to say that the idea that, you know, the UN Security Council, the UN General Assembly, that one country, one vote, that this idea of international law is Western, it's just wrong. There's no clear, there's no evidence that, that suggests that it was Western thinkers. Actually, quite to the contrary. It was developing countries like Mexico and Brazil and India, which insisted at the time of the San Francisco conferences that each country should have one vote. There was an American proposal at the time that larger industrialized Western countries should have more votes than poor developing countries, right? International law, I've mentioned, India and Brazil were the first two countries to bring the topic of apartheid to the UN General Assembly, which contradicts the notion that Western countries are not about intervening in other countries, for example. The case of pressuring other countries to adopt certain rules and norms is pretty much over history just as present in non-Western countries as in Western countries. Not always to promote positive things. China has a long history of seeking to intervene in neighboring countries, right? So does the United States in the Caribbean and in Central America. Not always with a positive effect. Now, today, the whole stakeholder narrative, the responsible stakeholder narrative overlooks that, for example, China already leads in many areas. China today has more peacekeepers in the field than all the other P5 combined, right? So a lot of people say, well, China is always inward looking, doesn't want to take the lead. But China actually has a battalion in South Sudan. It has military advisors in Iraq. It is building a huge base in Djibouti. And that's what you do when you're the second largest country with the expectations of becoming the largest. It's a natural thing to do. There's no, the idea that because it's non-Western, it will always be inward looking is sort of ludicrous. It is certainly held back by very obvious dynamics because there's a major power next to it, is India. It has Japan next to it. It has a lot of strong countries around it, which is a difficulty the United States never faced. So the United States was capable of projecting its power without having to worry about an invasion by Canada or Mexico, right? Which or countries that would contest its regional dominance, right? So the Western-centric worldview is even visible when we look at the map. This is the most common map that we use today, and it suggests that Greenland is larger than Africa, and it suggests that Scandinavia is larger than India. Of course, people sort of know that Scandinavia is not bigger than India, but the Mercator map actually does suggest that, and it's a it's a map that is that generates or that suggests that the West or Western powers are much more much larger than this map, which is the Hobart-Dyer map, which seeks to not focus on the exact border lines, but on the actual size of continents, and which shows here that Africa, for example, plays a much, much larger role, and of course that Greenland is not larger than Africa, which may be funny sort of to all of us, but a lot of people don't have access to the same knowledge, so they look at the map and get, I think, a very twisted sense of the world. This is a map that is no less adequate than a so-called northern-centric map, right? There's obviously no up and down in the world. Like, if you look at the Earth in space, but there's people who actually insist that this is a wrong map, right? So I have this map in my office, and people say, why is it upside down? I say, it's not upside down. It's just another way of looking at the world. That map is sometimes appears sort of in Argentina and sometimes in Brazil, but there's a many. What I'm trying to say is that the way we look at the world is somewhat northern centric. I'm not trying to promote this map, of course, but I did try to put this map on the cover, and the editor said it's not going to work. People will think we made a mistake. Right? It's too much. People will sort of say, I'm not getting this book. It's got like stuff. The editor is stupid, right? And the same occurs for that. Like the UN is looking at the world from, as one UN official said, we're looking at the world from the top, And I say, Jesus. And this is a Latin American diplomat. I said, this is wrong. You just look at it from the north, but the south isn't down. It's because we set it up like that. Why don't we make the UN symbol, change it to that one, right? It's more southern-centric. But anyway, so those are just a couple of examples that show that how pervasive that has shaped IR theory. Now, moving to the emerging power strategy, evidence, for example, countries, not wanting to, China being resistant about taking the lead on, certain issues. Now there's tension about the governance of the internet, et cetera. I mean, so basically looking at a tension between emerging countries and established ones, and saying, those countries are just are not going to agree with the rules and norms. Whereas Eikenberry said, our order is so cool. These countries will basically come in and they will become responsible stakeholders. And the strategy, I think, what I'm trying to make the case for in the book is that it's neither one nor the other. And it's actually a much smarter strategy because emerging countries are actually taking part in those institutions, but they're also creating parallel ones because the existing ones, particularly in the economic realm, have failed to integrate them adequately. Right? From a European perspective, the fact that there's never been a non-European head of the IMF is something that's a footnote. Right? It's not really important, but from a non-Western point of view, it's an indicative of the, not only the, it is above all of the unwillingness to actually make the IMF into actually a global organization. And the argument, and I was actually part of a Brazilian delegation. We were in Europe, and the argument, and a European, there was actually a German a diplomat who came to us and said, you know why the head of the IMF should be European? Because the most difficult crises right now are taking place in Europe, right? So we need somebody who understands Europe. And I said, but so why didn't we have a Latin American head of the IMF in the 80s? He's like, well, yeah, that was different, of course. So basically saying, okay, now we have the crisis, and that's why it needs to be European, is assuming that the rest are fools, because the idea that the worst crises are in Europe is very recent, but the institutions have obviously been led, above all, by French politicians for most of the time. And when Dominique Strauss-Kahn had to resign, the BRICS were too slow, and I'm thinking they were, which is also indicative of the difficulties the BRICS will have to shape global order. It took them too long to rally around one candidate. The Brazilians, for a number of reasons, were unwilling to support the Mexican candidate. So it became the current head of the IMF, Christine Lagarde. And the same was true with the World Bank, right? When Zulik resigned, there was an attempt to promote the Nigerian candidate, which would have made a tremendous difference, but the United States insisted actually on having a US head of the World Bank. Emerging countries, in response, did not pull out of those institutions, but they said there is no clear path towards being countries that have as much power as existing institutions, so we'll create a parallel system which is not going to actively undermine those, but which basically will be there so we can, we no longer depend entirely on those new institutions. So the results of that are foreign shopping and competitive multilateralism, which means that countries above all like China will be able to do exactly the same thing that the United States has done in the past, which is to choose the forum where you operate according to where you get most out of it, right? So when the financial crisis of 2008 was discussed, the General Assembly wanted to take up the topic, and there was a commission created by Stiglitz to articulate solutions to the crisis. And the United States imposed a lot of pressure, actually forced the UN to defund the commission so that it wouldn't have money to pay for the tickets to actually meet and write up a report, because the United States, of course, feared that the recommendations articulated and supported by the UN General Assembly would have negative consequences for U.S. national interest. So the G20 was created. Very, very smart move. Brazil felt, we're part of the G20, amazing. But basically what it did is drove a wedge between the G7 and the rest of the world. So basically the G20 dealt with the fallout and produced recommendations that were much, much less severe to U.S. national interest than the General Assembly would have articulated. And this is not something, I'm not saying that this is bad. This is obvious that the U.S. will do that, and China will try to do the same thing. So we have new institutions coming up, and China will, in the same way that the United States has done, seek to, as an addition to offering global public goods, it will seek to have it its way, basically, right? Have a basically be able to defend its interest through the use of international institutions. So they will, in that sense, the struggle in the future, and this is a wonderful thing, by the way, this is great, that the struggle will not be, am I going to invade this or that country? It will be, through which institution are we trying to solve this problem? Where am I seeking to promote my political power? So that's, in a sense, a hedging strategy. So that, because there's a recognition that through the order that has been created, the United States has several privileges. It's, what I say, the hegemonic privilege is basically that we follow the rules whenever, like mostly we follow the rules, but if you really have to break the rules, we'll just do it. Because of our centrality of the system, right? So when the United States invaded Iraq, there was nobody who said, let's expel the US from the G7. Right? Nobody said that because you can't expel the United States from the G7. Or OB said, let's impose sanctions on the United States. You can't do it because MasterCard and Visa and the SWIFT system is... Well, actually, the SWIFT system is based in the Netherlands, but MasterCard and Visa are based in the US, so you can't impose sanctions using a company that is in that same country, right? So that's so basically, centrality is too great, and what China is doing is to reduce the centrality, increase its autonomy by creating those new institutions. One of the elements in the book that I'm also discussing very quickly, you let me know when we stop, okay, is that, and I'll come to those institutions in a minute, we'll look at some of the examples, but is the notion that the West essentially has a monopoly on soft power. And the argument which is used makes a lot of sense, is that nobody in Europe wants to live like the Chinese, right? They have no human rights, and they have no freedom of the press, and you can't use Facebook. And my exchange students, most of the students who go to China actually do, criticize in the emails they send me. They said, "Oh, professor, I can't use Facebook. It's very difficult here in China." So, but above all, there's the belief that that the system, the democracy, Western, the liberal democracy, is more attractive, and that's why China will be unable to project the same amount of soft power that the West is projecting. And I'm not here to say that actually China's system is more attractive. What I'm saying is it's comparing two things which inevitably will make Europe or the United States look more attractive, because the same is actually true for India. India is a democracy, but people based in Europe, they are not crazy about moving for good to India. But that's not only about the fact that of democracy. That's because of the fact that India is a developing country, and it has all the things that come with being a developing country, just like China. The other element is that the Western notion that its soft power is primarily a result of its attractive culture overlooks that the actual reason why countries tend to align with the United States are based on national interest, right? Are based on security guarantees, are based on security alliances, on free trade deals, and on the provision of global public goods, right? Not being friends with the United States is very costly in international relations, right? For if you don't align with the US, or if you risk being punished by the US, the cost for you is significant, and most countries do it in a very subtle way, right? It's soft balancing, sort of, you know, not necessarily implement everything the United States asks you to do, but certainly not sort of going all the way, because most small countries know what that causes, either complete isolation or being invaded, right? Which is a general thing that hegemons do. That has nothing to do with the fact that the US is Western. That has occurred in the past as well. But so what is important is that those provisions of public goods, security alliance, all that China can provide as well, right? So of course our children or our grandchildren will not watch the Chinese version of Friends or House of Cards, right? So the United States continues to have that capacity to, you know, to ensure that to have sort of cultural leadership in that sense, capable of exporting that. And most countries, I suspect, despite the current crisis, will want to have some sort of more institutionalized degree in institutionalized right in decision making. So people want some kind of democracy. But the major source of Western soft power today lies in its capacity to create and sustain an order that creates global public goods. And that's why governments around the world don't want to be at odds with the US, right? Now, most of those things China will also provide. It has nothing to do with the fact that it's democratic or not. So from a theoretical point of view, what I'm doing here is I'm questioning the idea of the affirmation of liberal theory, or saying that, you know, democracies can do better with other democracies, et cetera, is to say that the leadership that the United States has exercised over the past decades is not as much tied to its Western culture as most people would like to believe. And that's why the notion that China cannot lead and China cannot be accepted as global leader, I think, is wrong. Because, and we see it in the example of the Philippines, I was 2 years, during the research of this book, I was at Brookings, and I presented a paper where it said, China may be capable of being accepted as regional leader by its region through its economic policy, OBOR, right? One belt, one road. Basically, it will put so much money into neighboring countries that those countries cannot do anything but accept Chinese leadership in the same way that the United States has done in the past, right after World War II. And somebody got up, I can't remember who, he said that this is, I just give you the example of the Philippines. The Philippines have been the major ally of the United States for 100 years, and they will be the major ally of the United States for another 100 years, right? Now, if you look at what just happened, I'm not saying that the case of the Philippines is indicative of a broad regional trend. And if you go to Vietnam, people, despite the fact that they haven't been invaded by the United States in the 60s, they still fear China much, much more than the United States, right? Everybody who travels to Vietnam knows that. But the Philippines kind of seem to have switched sides, right? They're much closer to China now. They're denigrating the United States. Could be an outlier, but could also be the beginning of a trend. What I'm saying is, it's no longer impossible to criticize the US as it was the case sort of 100 years ago, right? 10 years ago. The kind of the cost of being at odds with the US will decrease, and the cost of being at odds with China will increase. And I'm not sure if it was Norway, Sweden or Norway, which suffered quite a lot from isolation. Norway, right. A lot of people looked at that and said, you know, I don't want to go through that experience, right? I mean, basically, the number of countries, and this is a negative example, the number of heads of state willing to meet the Dalai Lama has dropped so dramatically because you just don't want to do it, right? You don't want to have all the trouble, the economic trouble that, right? So you just don't do it. I was in São Paulo at a time when the Dalai Lama was there, and he wanted to meet the governor, because the president had said, I'm of course not meeting the Dalai Lama, it's too dangerous. And he said, okay, let's meet the second most powerful person in Brazil, it's the governor of São Paulo. And the governor of São Paulo said, are you kidding me? I'm in the middle of this negotiation of this huge investment. There's no way I can meet. So the vice governor, and then the Dalai Lama was like, you know, we could talk to the media and say that nobody here can meet us, it's quite bad. And they said, okay, we'll make a deal. You'll meet the vice governor, but you'll run into the vice governor. So the vice governor is not there as vice governor. He's just there at the cocktail. He happens to be there, and the Dalai Lama too, right? And no pictures, right? So that's the new reality, right? I mean, this is of course not an example of sort of Chinese soft power. What I'm saying is that shows how the influence, the capacity for countries to align with China has become become massive now. And it's nothing, you don't need to be sort of culturally attractive in order to exert influence on countries. And this idea of soft power, and Joe Nye says, well, China has no soft power. But one of the elements of having soft power is, for example, the capacity to send food aid very quickly or to help you evacuate lots of people. Now, China can do that, right? You don't have to be a Western democratic country to immediately send, when there's a famine in Ethiopia, the Chinese come in and the Chinese can distribute the food quicker. And that will help, obviously, make Ethiopia more aligned to China. Now, very quickly, how does that parallel order what does that look like? And I have in the book very quickly sort of described the non-Western institutions and the traditional institutions and sort of pair them a bit up by showing how, above all, China, of course, is creating an order that at some point may be capable, that complements it today, but at some point may be capable of making the existing order less important. So the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank is a really interesting example. It's also a really interesting example of how Western centrism not only shapes IR theory, but it also shapes policymaking. I received a delegation of U.S. diplomats at the time of the creation of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, who asked me, how can we convince Brazil not to be a founding member of the AIIB? This would be really bad, they said, because this would give the AIIB a global, you know, it would give it a global characteristic, because you'd be the only ones in the Americas to be a founding member. What can we do to avoid that, right? So, very interesting example, and the US organized a diplomatic campaign to convince other countries not to join the AIIB, right? Saying that, well, we don't know about, you know, how is it exactly going to work, so we're just going to put a lot of pressure on everybody not to join it. But basically, this was because the AIIB will, and it's fairly obvious, supplant at some point the Asian Development Bank, where the United States, through Japan, has tremendous political influence, right? So that shows that non-Western leadership internationally is largely seen as disruptive. It's bad because it wants to weaken existing order. You could just as well say, wait a minute, this is great. I mean, China is taking the lead here, right? China is really doing a lot to promote economic development. Does it do it because it wants to reduce the probability of countries in its region of breaking from China? Of course. But that was also one of the reasons for creating the World Bank and the IMF, right? The World Bank didn't give credits to countries in the Soviet bloc, right? They supported countries in the free world. So in a sense, it was, of course, a project that was tied to US national interests as well. BRICS Development Bank, another example. A lot of pressure from the United States at the time for Brazil not to be part of the bank. Also, the major idea here that academia has asked, does this bank destabilize international order, rather than saying, look at those countries providing global public goods. Very interesting, right? That is not the way we tend to look at that. And a lot of those ideas here, I'm not going to go through all of them, but China Union Pay, I think, is a really interesting example, because it's not very known outside of China or outside of the region where China operates. But one of the reasons why China is very interested in internationalizing CUP is because in a possible moment of future conflict, it doesn't want to depend on MasterCard and Visa, which are actually an intimate element of international relations, because they are the vehicles of imposing sanctions on countries when they misbehave. And because both countries, both companies are based in the West, from a Chinese perspective, this is an uneven playing field. And if you've ever traveled to Sudan, North Korea, or Iran, you will know that there you can't use your MasterCard and your Visa, right? Because they're cut off from the system. Now, there was at the time after the annexation of Crimea by the Russians, there was a debate in the US Congress about whether the United States should push for cutting off Russia from the Visa and MasterCard network, which would have had tremendous consequences for the Russian economy. The decision was made not to, but China looked at that and said, if 5 years down the line, we've got trouble and the United States is pushing from cutting us off Visa and MasterCard, we need to have a system in place that will allow us to, that will basically not cut us off from the global economy, right? So the promotion of China UNP, of course, is an attempt to reduce the dependency of China on those those structures, right? So we've got several other examples here, which I'm not going to go into. Universal Credit Rating Group, also interesting example, which is not really that apparent from a Western perspective, but there is a fear outside of the West that those which are essentially a global public good, right, ratings, can be used as a tool for Western coercion, right? And that it is necessary to have your own tools. Now, that sounds kind of bad. I'm giving a couple of bad examples. At the same time, I think in several of those cases, such as the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank and the Asian Development Bank, I think it can be quite positive because there can be learning, right? There's new institutions coming in, and you'll have competition between those institutions, right? There's no apparent, there's no clear reason why having two banks is worse than having one. Of course, those could be used potentially sort of for strategic reasons, but I think everybody agrees that Asia, I forgot the exact number, but Asia needs several billions of dollars a year to update its infrastructure, right? There's really no clear reason why we wouldn't benefit from having new institutions here. So this was in the area of finance, trade, investment, of course. China is promoting the RCEP, which again is another example of a country that takes the lead and does so by promoting rules and norms and leads institutions that provide benefits to those involved. And this is, of course, the Trump administration in many ways is a gift to China because pulling out of the TPP makes the probability of RCEP being successful much greater. Now, in order of security, we have several organizations there as well. Not all of them are new, but it does show that there is activity in all of those areas taking place. And in the area of diplomacy, I would say the BRICS Leader Summit has become very, very important. There's still a bias, I think, in the way we look at this. The G7 summits get a lot of media attraction, whereas the BRICS Leader Summit are fairly secondary, or as I said initially, seen as kind of a disruptive force. But what happens there is actually quite interesting. And in Brazil, for example, the BRICS idea was seen as a center-left idea for a long time. I remember when I started doing this research, several of my more conservative colleagues said, but that's like a Lula agenda. You can't do that. That's like that's a really sort of ideological thing because BRICS isn't really important. But we have now the current government, which is center-right, has embraced actually the BRICS concept as well for a very obvious reason, because it is indeed one of the most important trips of the Brazilian president. So you can no longer not go to the BRICS summit. Also in terms of the Boao Forum of Asia, supposing the non-Western capacity to set the agenda is also a tool that will be used in that sense. And in terms of infrastructure, I think OBOR is really quite important. The Nicaragua Canal, the idea of building a canal other than the Panama Canal and focusing on Latin America in general is actually quite interesting because from a long-term planning perspective from China, this is the partnership with Latin America is very important China will depend increasingly on Latin America to import raw materials and food above all. So there's major attempts here to, through the provision of the financing of infrastructure, bring countries closer to China. The number of countries that recognize Taiwan in Latin America is of course falling as a consequence of that, which is related to the last point that I made. So to conclude, the new order that we're looking at is, of course, much more complex. It requires us to, in our IR discussion, to not only know, for example, domestic US politics, which traditionally has been important, because we have to know, for example, what is the US president going to do? So any kind of IR scholar must know what kinds of actions by the US president require congressional approval, right? So that's kind of a thing that we tend to know, because the president is very, very important to shape the global order and has been for the past decades. That will no longer be enough. So basically each department will have to have somebody who looks at Chinese domestic policy, for example. We need to have specialists in non-Western institutions, but above all in non-Western thought. Now the whole idea, of course, one of the major criticisms of this entire research project is that by creating the West versus rest division, you're reinforcing Western centrism. And that is partly true, because the idea that you have a West and a non-West would be saying, I'll divide the animal kingdom between the rhinos and the non-rhinos. Makes no sense, right? Completely mad. And because it suggests that the West, which represents sort of 9% of the global population, is one thing and the rest is something else. Completely, it's completely wrong, right? And post-Western world, the idea doesn't suggest that we're going to be non-Western anyway. It's going to be, say, post in a sense that we don't know yet what it's going to be called, but it's certainly not Western, right? Sort of going beyond that Western-centric point of view will require to look at dynamics and also at non-Western dynamics and at looking at non-Western examples to build theory. A lot of people say, well, the realists aren't really Western-centric because they just say that countries behave according to the distribution of power, right? That's what they do. There's no culture involved. Realists don't care about culture. But a lot of realists are actually Western-centric by only using historical examples that involve Western countries, right? Thucydides's trap, right? That's sort of like, it would be, so Thucydides's trap is sort of the old, you know, the Athens and Sparta, because that is kind of Western. I mean, that's kind of, as I said, the precursor of the West. Very few realists look at sort of the relationship between, I don't know, Korea and China 300 years ago or something like that. So in that sense, I think in order for the theory to make sense to people to predict the future, it must decentralize as well and sort of follow that process of material decentralization that's taking place right now in the process of multi-polarization. But what is the good thing about that? The good thing is that the trend towards a broader distribution of power will force actors involved to actually find slower, more difficult, but essentially more democratic decision-making procedures. Now, of course, you could say, well, it's not really democratic to have non-democratic countries involved in that process, but even the move towards the G20, the move away from the G7, or to maintain the G7 and to have the BRICS concept is, in a sense, much, much more inclusive to have new institutions, to have countries that promote their own institutions that have influence beyond their regions, shows that we've got more than just Western countries now taking the lead internationally. And that, in a sense, provides an opportunity for better cooperation. I could speak for another 4 hours, but I'll decide not to. So thank you very much.
I'm sure we could have listened to you for
another
hour.
No.
I think it would be good to open for a few questions. Yes, of course. Or comments from the audience, if there's any.
They're numbed.
Yeah. First of all, thanks for the very clear seminar. I have a question maybe in twofold. Thank you. Of course, it's clear that our international system will be totally transformed by the rise of China. That made me wonder about our international financial system. Are the Chinese preparing for a post-dollar monetary system by not only producing huge amounts of gold but also buying them up? And what would that mean for our financial system? Are we not like facing harder times than in 2008? We owe trillions of dollars to the US, and what would happen if to the China, and what will happen if China is not there to pop up the dollar anymore?
What's your name, sorry?
Jorn.
Okay. Would you like me to take it? Yeah, I can ask. I mean, I'll be quick in each one. There's something here. Okay, so I think there is no clear argument for, I mean, the idea is, of course, that the centrality of the US dollar has provided a tremendous amount of financial stability over the past decades, right? And that allowed the United States to be sort of the guarantor of the system, in a sense, which is one of the reasons why we've had also so few financial crises. And I would even say that in that respect, I don't see an incentive to destroy each other. I would actually say there is this mutual economic destruction, in a sense, you have, right? So so that's why China can't sell off its U.S. dollars, because it of course would destroy the U.S. economy, but it would also cause the Chinese economy to crash. So that's interesting enough. I think that having sort of a second pillar and having the yuan substitute the euro sort of or other currencies, and then really rise up to be one of the major currencies, I think is something that wouldn't necessarily destabilize the international system. Now, I do think it'll take a long time. There's one section in the book where I look at sort of the perspectives of having China internationalized for real, the yuan, which is still not entirely free-floating. And I'll say that I think that it will take a long time, but I would actually think that it would help modernize the Chinese economy too, right? It would require China to take several steps to free up its economy, which I think now it's not willing to take. So my expectation would be that this is something that takes another 10, 15 years perhaps. There's of course a power struggle within China of some groups that want to promote the internationalization of its currency, and other groups that are very much against it, because it would require them to end sort of a very protected system that's not very transparent, the financial system in China. But I don't, again, I don't think it should be something we're worried about, because I think the positive effects for dealing with China would outweigh the potential systemic effects of destabilizing it.
Thank you very much. Very, very, very interesting. I had a comment and a question. The comment, I mean, I agree basically with your main thesis, but I mean, if I was American, I would be worried about what's happening, not because of the collapse of the global order, but because of the collapse of the American-controlled global order. I mean, the global order exists as long as at the moment, as long as the US allows it and to some extent controls it. And so, although that may not be the case for other parts of the Western world, I think it's very understandable that Americans think this is threatening to the global order. But my question relates to trade, because were able to talk about it briefly, but obviously this is a very important and complex issue as well. I mean, I agree with you that Trump has given is a gift to China, but before Trump, as it were, pre-Trump, what did you see as the trends? What was China doing, in a sense, that parallels what you were describing in some of the other sectors?
Right, so I agree with you that, and again, this may be worrying to the US, because the United States will no longer have the liberty to act sort of, how I call it, sort of act without a permission slip, which it has had the hegemonic privilege a bit, right? Sort of to say, we have a set of rules and norms, but if it really is sort of important, we can break them. We won't suffer from it as a smaller country would, right? So I agree with that. What I think is problematic is that literature then is exported to elsewhere and to sort of automatically says, just because that may impact US national interest means that this is worse for the system as a whole, right? And because of the let's say intellectual hegemony, I think that is still taking place because of this bias of our theory, we oftentimes adopt that sort of fairly negative view about the rise of others, even though the implications for Brazil aren't that clear, in a sense. Now, I wrote the entire book during the Obama presidency, so a lot of people have obviously said, what does Trump mean for that? I would say, I think to some extent, I say it's very early right now, because I think not even the president knows what's going to happen tomorrow, right, this afternoon. I mean, it's completely sort of uncertain. But I think even already this uncertainty does, in a sense, benefit China tremendously, because we're now in a crazy, in a situation that, which I'm not at all sort of happy about, but basically what you're saying is the greatest political risk today emanates from democracies, right? I mean, people, like the stock market goes crazy before the French election, then we have the German. So the three big risks to the global stability today, this year, were the Dutch election, the German, I mean, If you had said that 4 years ago, everybody would have said you're crazy. I mean, the big risks are a revolution in China and the overthrow of Putin in Russia or the Saudi government, right? So so I think that China has, even under Obama, has sought to sell its own model, of course, right? So there was attempts. The RCEP has been pushed for years as a counter model to the TPP, which China was not included in for a whole series of reasons, because it would have required domestic reforms that the Chinese government wasn't willing to make, right? The creation of independent unions and all these kinds of things. So I think the battle for geopolitical influence through trade deals has been in place before Trump. And I very much believe in it, that one of the roles of a country that leads is to lead trade deals as well, which allows countries to the other side also to benefit, but which ties them to you in a way that makes it more difficult for them to break away from you. And I think there was this battle. I would have, until Trump got elected, I remember the day before the election, I had a call with a friend at the Brazilian ministry, and I said, Hillary is going to somehow pull this off. I mean, she's going to sign the TPP. I mean, this whole anti-trade stuff, she's not going to implement, right? Now I think they're really, there's no way to resuscitate it from the US. So I think it's a great, it comes to tremendous benefit for China that is able to shape now the way that trade will be articulated in the next, at least next 4 years in Asia. So I think it's not something that's new under Trump, but I think Trump has pulled out of that race, which I think ends up accelerating or facilitating China's diplomatic work in Asia, I think.
Dan Bannock, I found this really interesting. I think it's about time we came up with an alternative to the established system. But I think just in the introduction, I can say that there's a fundamental difference in the way the US or people in the US perceive the world, including academics, and how Indians and Chinese and Brazilians perceive the world. In Brazil, people are often very surprised that they're part of this group at all. They're extremely humble. So we're not emerging, we haven't emerged, you know, we're still developing. In China, it's still a lot of the same. I'm there 5 times a year. They don't really have that arrogance that often Americans would have at meetings, at the Brookings, at Carnegie, or at Stanford. It's always about maintaining the American pole position. So I think that is the fundamental difference, just to get things started, is how one perceives the world. I don't think the Chinese really have that world domination as their goal. I think a lot of people in the West misunderstand that when they use the term neocolonialism, particularly in relation to China in Africa, but also in Latin America. But now, I think you did a really good job of showing the different alternative global institutions that correspond to existing Western control institutions. However, I would argue that you paint too rosy a picture of Asia. I think you forget the fact, just last week, China, by its support for Pakistan and Pakistan's entry into several of these organizations, has driven yet another wedge between India and China. And so one of the things that I would question when you are painting this extremely positive picture is the fact that this blip that you call it, right, has worked rather well for a long time because of trust, because of predictability, because of faith in institutions, or whatever that special relationship was between the US and the UK. There was this fundamental agreement and this ability to predict to a certain or large extent. With this new world order, there is no predictability. Mm-hmm. You read David Shambaugh's work on China, you know, there are 4 alternatives. And, you know, is it totalitarianism, continuation of what is going on, soft authoritarianism? You know, there's all this kind of worry. India is obsessed with China. China doesn't care for India. China is obsessed with the US. The existence of the Chinese model of the regime is really dependent on providing the population with an American lifestyle. And yet, what are Chinese investors doing? they're really investing in property in the US, in Africa, because they fear for their own country's future. So I would just question this rosy picture that you're presenting of Asia's reemergence and dominance. I think that really has to be tempered down a bit. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, that's right in a sense that the, particularly in Asia, I think you have a low degree of institutionalization right now still. There are a lot of points of friction where tensions could emerge. I mean, India and China have gone to war in the 60s, the situation hasn't changed other than India being much stronger now than it was in the 60s, so it would possible confrontation would be much more consequential. And I think it's right. What I mean, you're basically saying is it was because the United States acted and continued to act as kind of a stabilizer in Asia that explains partly the possibility for Asia to rise without having tensions between those and sort of having now the U.S. No longer, without the United States playing that role, there's a greater...
I'm not actually interested in the U.S. at all. I'm just talking about the situation.
Right. Yeah, and I think you're right. I think there needs to be a redefinition of the order that exists in Asia in a sense that will require much greater sort of agency and a much greater regional integration than there is today, right? I mean, I would say if you ask me what is the biggest risk of conflict sort of in the long term, I would certainly say it's in Asia, right? Where you have sort of conflict between India and China, for example. So I'm not saying that there will be sort of no conflict, no friction in that sense. What I'm questioning is that, I mean, you said that there were benefits, and of course, because of unipolarity, you had no major power conflict, per definition, because it's just one great power, right? So you can't have you can't have a conflict between those. At the same time, I think it's also worth mentioning that the participation of countries like India in the Western system is fairly recent too, right? So, and a lot of countries have gone to war between each other or within in that Western system. But so I'm not saying that things will be much easier in that sense. I think it is, for example, necessary for the situation in Asia to institutionalize more in order to avoid, you know, tensions because of China's growing influence in Central Asia, in Pakistan, in Afghanistan. You know, huge problem for India. Exactly how to deal with the growing influence in China in India's entire neighborhood, right? The only thing I'm not convinced is that the long-term solution of that is to keep sort of things as they are right now. I'm not necessarily certain that even if, let's say, the United States, for example, and I know that wasn't a particular point, but just the maintenance of the U.S. in Asia would somehow resolve that any more than this new situation we're seeing right now, which is basically all about the rise of Asia. When it comes to the U.S., you said the Chinese are investing in the United States, for example, and other places, and not within their country. And I think you're right. I think there is a chance. I think Shambo is a bit too pessimistic about China. I think we have, particularly in IR theory, I think there's such a conviction that China's system cannot last. It somehow must collapse. I feel that, I mean, he's made the prediction, I think, in late 2016, that he said the Communist Party is on the verge of collapse, for example. I'm not here to argue that China will have that rule for another, you know, 100 years or so. And actually, in the book, I do sort of list the major challenges that the Chinese regime faces, like demographic imbalances, pollution, massive need to restructure its economy, excessive dependency on SEOs, et cetera, et cetera. So I think if you do have a collapse of China, of the Chinese economy, then all of these initiatives will actually sort of temporarily come to a halt. But I don't know. I mean, you also travel to China a lot, I know. But my sense is, I didn't have the sense. But this is like something for us to argue, for many meetings in the future. I don't have the sense that that there is an imminent sort of collapse or the risk of an imminent collapse. And the final thing about the desire to promote Chinese values, I completely agree with you. I think there's no attempt to make sure that the Africans live according to Asian rules and norms or anything like that. So in that sense, I think that will facilitate China's role in other regions rather than, particularly in comparison to the role of Western powers. So I think what you're saying is, when I hear that, is that is actually in places China will have an easier time operating than the West used to have because of its more restrained activity.
Thank you. I think we'll just have one more question, and then we'll wrap it up.
Yes, thank you very much for an interesting speech. My name is Solveig Amat. I work at CICERO Center for International Climate Research here in Oslo. My question goes more to IR as a field, not as much to what you think will happen in the world, irrespective of IR theory. Because the past dependence in IR that you describe, it also affects how we ask questions, the questions that we as a field ask. And I study Indian climate policy, and usually not many people are too interested, but now they're really interested in how the Trump or Brexit is going to influence climate policy in India. And when I say that probably it isn't, then it's not interesting anymore.
Right.
But how can we as a field avoid this path dependence in our research programs? Because often the people that have the traditional IR thinking are also the ones that take decisions on what direction our research is going, what new projects to support, and how to think about our field going forward. So that's my question. What do you think we should do as a field?
Yeah. I think one of the challenges remains that, I mean, there's both practical and sort of strategic problems. One of the practical problems is that the vast majority of scholars around the world has no access to the leading journals, for example. I mean, I get this all the time. You sort of publish an article and then people in Bolivia and Kenya in Cambodia write to you and say, oh, I've kind of heard you, you know, I'm following you on Facebook and I saw you publish this article, but my university doesn't provide access to this, which is not, this is something global. There's a huge concentration of publications in one place, and I think one of the challenges for academic communities, non-Western academic communities, is to make research more accessible, to promote quality. China has been the only one who has done that actually so far successfully. I mean, China Quarterly and sort of other journals are world class and that are based at Chinese universities now. And I think it would be necessary to do and support projects that do that in other regions of the world. India is actually also is moving along those lines, but I think you'd see very little of that in other parts of the world. And the other thing is, I think, as the field, sort of, I think is to promote exchange programs in to other places. I mean, it's still very, very common that the majority of exchange students from anywhere in the world will seek to study in very particular places, and I think that's a weakness because it creates that sort of dependency. And again, I struggle a lot to convince my students to go to China, for example, because they, you know, they prefer to go to Lisbon or Barcelona, which like is, I think, you know, they shouldn't be doing that. They should like go to China and then spend the vacation in Barcelona if they want to. But I mean, that's sort of the, I think universities then need to also globalize and have intra BRICS, for example, exchange programs. And that's one of the shortcomings. This is not, I'm not blaming anybody, but the governments, for example, of BRICS countries, there's not a single double diploma program between BRICS countries, for example, right? There's no connection between the global south of people in the global south to actually be thinking about these things in broader terms. So I think that is one of the challenges that those universities also face, that their only exchange programs many times are with US institutions, European institutions, and so on. So in that sense, I think it's, I think the theory has a long way to go, but as weird as it sounds, I'm actually quite heartened by the efforts made by Chinese universities, which have, you know, the Schwarzman Fellow program and all these kinds of things, which are a first step, which I hope then will be replicated by other the regions. I think India would be sort of the third natural candidate to do that. There's quite a development in the Middle East where American universities are creating regional campuses. And basically, I think Latin America is perhaps a laggard. I mean, it's the only region in the world, for example, where international think tanks don't build field offices because there's no money there, or it's too difficult to operate, et cetera. So in that sense, I think it's also more of a strategic role that universities, think tanks, et cetera, have to do to build a global presence in order to hear perspectives from different places.
Thank you very much for good answers. I think we have a job to do here at the University of Oslo, and I hope that the Oslo Academy of Global Governance can contribute a little bit to that task that you're kind of sketching that we have ahead of us. Thanks to all of you. I think it's good that you put up the website here, and also check out Oslo Academy of Global Governance for future events of this kind. Thank you very much.
Thank you.